Shalom. I'm Eddie Chumney of Hebraic Heritage Ministries, and we welcome you today to our study on the Hebraic roots of Christianity. We need to remember that whenever we're studying the Hebraic roots of Christianity, we must keep everything centered on Yeshua the Messiah. That is because it is written in Psalm chapter 40, verse 7, "Then said I, Lo, I come." In the volume of the book, it is written of me. That verse is quoted of Yeshua in Hebrews in chapter 10 and verse 7, that in the volume of the book, or the totality of Scripture, it is written of him. Then Yeshua himself stated in Luke chapter 24, verse 44, "These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the Torah of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me." Therefore, Yeshua stated that the Hebrew Scriptures are written of him, that the Torah is written of him. Therefore, if we are to fully understand our Bible in its context from Genesis to Revelation, we need to first see Yeshua in the Torah and see the connection of him in the Torah to his first coming and his second coming. And primary in seeing Yeshua in the Torah is realizing that Yeshua gave the Torah at Mount Sinai. And we can see this by looking at the New Testament. And if we just first accept that Yeshua is our Savior and that he saves his people from their sins, we can make a connection in the New Testament that Yeshua gave the Torah at Mount Sinai. So in Matthew, in chapter 1, verse 21, it is written, "And she," referring to Mary, "shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name in Hebrew Yeshua," which means salvation, "for he shall save his people from their sins." And then in Luke, in chapter 2 and verse 11, it is written, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." So Yeshua is our Savior, and he saves his people from their sins. By understanding this, now we can go to James in chapter 4 and verse 12. The first part of the verse says that there is one lawgiver who is able to save. The one that is able to save is the one that gave the Torah at Mount Sinai. Yeshua in John chapter 14, verse 15, instructed those who believed in him with these words, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Well, in stating these words, Yeshua was making a reference to the very first place in the Bible where we see the phrase, "love me and keep my commandments." And that is found in the chapter on the giving of the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20 and verse 6. The one that brought his people out of Egypt, that gave the Torah at Mount Sinai, said the following, showing mercy or grace unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. And so the God of Israel shows mercy and grace to those that seek to love him by keeping his commandments or following his Torah. In Psalm 103, verses 17 and 18, it is written, "But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. It is eternal. The grace, the mercy of the God of Israel is everlasting. There is not a certain period of time in history that is the age of grace. Mercy or grace is a characteristic of the God of Israel himself. Since he has always existed, his grace or his mercy has always existed. And we're told that the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. Verse 18, to them that keep his covenant and to those that remember his commandments and to do them. The God of Israel gives grace to those who endeavor to love him, keep his commandments, and follow his Torah. Why? Because sometimes we fail. And when we fail, we need to confess our sins, and we need his mercy and his grace to forgive us of our sins, so that through his help and his guidance, which he gives us by his Holy Spirit, we can then seek to continue to love him, seek to continue to keep his commandments. And in order to help us in doing so, he has given us his indwelling Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of truth that's going to lead and guide us in all truth, John chapter 16, verse 13. And by putting his Spirit within us, Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27, it will cause us to keep his statutes, his commandments, and judgments and do them. And this is the Torah that Paul advocated that we follow. Paul said in Romans chapter 7, verse 22, I delight in the Torah of God after the inward man. The inward man is the one that has the indwelling Holy Spirit. And so, the issue in the first century, if you believed in the God of Israel, if you were a part of the nation of Israel, if you were a part of the covenant people, if you believed in the Messiah of Israel, the issue wasn't whether you should follow the Torah. The issue in the debate became, how do I follow that Torah? Because in the first century, there were the Pharisees, and they taught the people that the way that you were to follow the Torah was to do so from the instruction of the rabbis. And so Yeshua, he said in Matthew in chapter 5, in verses 17 and 18, do not think that I've come to destroy the Torah and the prophets. I've not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, not one jot or tittle will pass from the Torah till all be fulfilled. And so, as we have covered in previous teachings, that Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, in order to understand this correctly, we need to realize that this is a Hebrew idiom, that to destroy the Torah means to incorrectly interpret it and teach it. To fulfill the Torah means to correctly teach what the Torah says. So Yeshua, because he gave the Torah, he mentioned that he came to give the correct understanding in teaching of it. He did not come to give the incorrect teaching and understanding of the Torah, which means not only did he come to explain the heart of the Torah, but he came to explain where those who were teaching the Torah were erring and were doing so incorrectly. And so we are doing a series, Torah and the New Testament. And we are looking at those passages which traditional Christianity cites to teach that we are not to follow the Torah in expressing our faith in Yeshua as the Messiah. Now keep in mind, the Bible is very clear, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, that we are saved by grace through faith. It's not based upon our own merit, our own ability. It's not even based upon our own efforts to seek to follow the Torah. But given that we are saved through the blood of Yeshua, by His grace, through faith, Paul asked this question in Romans chapter 3, verse 31. Do we make void or do away with the Torah through faith? Because we're saved by grace through faith, do we not follow the Torah? That is the question that he asked. Well, he answers the question. He says, God forbid we establish the Torah. And so then Paul went on to say, in establishing the Torah, how he sought to follow the Torah. He followed the Torah by the Holy Spirit. In Romans chapter 7, verse 22, he says, I delight in the Torah of God after the inward man. And so, not realizing this issue, and it being an issue in the first century, traditional Christianity now is looking at a Jewish debate on how you follow the Torah and thinking that the debate is over whether you should follow the Torah or not. And such was not the case. It was how you follow the Torah. Do you follow the Torah from the instruction of the one who gave it, Yeshua, by His Spirit? Or do you follow it from the authorities that were set up, who said that they were given authority to teach and instruct the Torah, and the ones who professed that that was so were the rabbis or Pharisaic Judaism. And so we're now going to look at Matthew in chapter 15, and we're going to look at this in its detail and see what the issue is in the point that Yeshua is making. And in doing so, we're going to see that Yeshua is going to correctly teach what it means to follow the Torah. So, Matthew chapter 15, verse 1. Then came to Yeshua scribes and Pharisees. Now, the first thing we need to realize, since it was the scribes and the Pharisees that were coming to him, and they asked him the following question in verse 2, why do the disciples of Yeshua transgress the tradition of the elders? Now, the tradition of the elders is what is called the oral law. And in the oral law, which is the teaching of the rabbis, they teach that you must wash your hands before you eat if you're going to be following the Torah that was given at Mount Sinai. But Yeshua's disciples did not have a regular practice of washing their hands before they ate, violating the oral law. But there is no written commandment that says you must wash your hands before you eat. And so the question is, why do the disciples transgress the tradition of the elders, for they wash not their hands when they eat bread? So Yeshua's reply is the following in verse 3. Why do you transgress the commandment of God? That is the written commandment of God by your tradition or your oral teaching. So then he gives an example how the written instruction is to honor your father and your mother, which comes from one of the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20. But the way in which they teach this thing, they were nullifying the heart or the intent of honoring your father and your mother. So he says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 6, that you've made the commandment of God, the written commandment of God, to have none effect by your tradition or your interpretation of how you apply honoring your father and mother. So therefore, he calls them hypocrites, and then he refers to what Isaiah the prophet said regarding them from Isaiah chapter 29, verse 13, where it says, this people draw nigh unto me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And So it says in verse 9, in vain they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Yeshua was quoting Isaiah. And since he is the one that gave the Torah at Mount Sinai, and they, that is the Pharisees and the scribes, were endeavoring to follow the Torah, Yeshua gave the Torah, he says that you're doing it in vain. In vain you worship me, teaching for doctrines, that would be the oral law, the commandments of men. And so, even though the Pharisees and the scribes here did not believe that Yeshua is the Messiah, nevertheless, Yeshua said in vain they are worshiping him, even though they don't believe that he's the Messiah. So in what way is Yeshua saying that they're worshiping him, even though they're doing it in vanity by their teaching or the way that they are seeking to follow the Torah? Is because instead of following the Torah by the Holy Spirit, that they are doing it from the teachings or the instructions of men who are claiming the authority from God and that what they teach is of God. So the only way that Yeshua can say in vain they worship me when in their efforts to follow the Torah, when they don't believe that he's the Messiah, the only way that they could say that they're worshiping him is if he gave the Torah at Mount Sinai. And so then he goes on to say in verse 10, hear and understand, not that which goes into the mouth defiles a man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. Now, that verse has been quoted as proof to say that we can eat anything that we want because it's not that which goes into the mouth that defiles a man. So if that which goes into the mouth doesn't defile a man, then they say, well, you could eat anything you want, but it's that, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles the man. So it's not that which goes into the mouth that defiles a man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. And so that is an answer that is given in the context of answering the question, why do the disciples transgress the tradition of the elders, for they wash not their hands when they eat? So Yeshua is answering that question, oral law versus written law. He's not giving a teaching on food and that you can eat anything that you want. And so even the disciples of Yeshua understood that Yeshua was not giving a teaching literally on food and saying that you could eat anything that you want, because in Matthew chapter 15, verse 15, Peter said unto him, declare unto us this parable. So the words of Yeshua, not that which goes into the mouth defiles a man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. Peter rendered that saying as a parable. And so then Yeshua goes on to explain, verse 16, are you not without understanding? Do you not understand that that which enters in at the mouth goes into the belly and is cast out of the draught? But those things which proceed out of the mouth comes forth from the heart, and they defile a man. So true defilement comes from evil heart, evil thought, evil intent. For out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witnesses, blasphemies. Yeshua is saying that is the source of the problem. And so they ask him a question that why did the disciples transgress the traditions of the elders? For they wash not their hands when they eat. And so ultimately, the focus of the question was the external, whether you washed your hands before you ate. And so first Yeshua said that why do you transgress the commandment by your tradition. So that's the first point that he made. And then the second point that he made was the real issue is not making your hands clean physically and thinking that you're all right with God, that the real point is having your heart right and having your heart proper toward God. Because the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. So we need to look at Matthew chapter 15 in context. Once again, we want to highlight for you the context of the chapter in the context of, in the point that Yeshua was making. First of all, Yeshua was being asked a question by the scribes and the Pharisees. Now, they would be following oral law, meaning they put the oral law or the teaching of the rabbis above the written law, believing that the rabbis have the authority to interpret the written, so therefore their interpretation they teach is how you follow the Torah, and that how they teach it, that they are infallible. And so that's the first point, is who's asking the question? What are they asking? They're asking, why do the disciples of Yeshua not follow the oral law or the teaching of the rabbis, the teaching of the Pharisees? And we're told specifically what the accusation was, that they do not wash their hands when they eat. So according to the oral law, you must physically wash your hands before you eat. And then it's taught that now when you eat, you're clean before God. So Yeshua is making the point that it's possible to physically wash your hands, but if you have an evil heart, that your heart isn't right toward God. So you can wash the external, but if the internal is evil, then you are not in the place with God where you need to be. So then he gives them an example of how their interpretation of the written violates the heart of the condition, where the written commandment is honor your father and your mother. He gives them an example how through their interpretation they violate that heart of it. And so he says that you've made the commandment of God to have none effect, the heart of the purpose of the commandment, by your interpretation, by your tradition. And then he says that because of your incorrect interpretation and teaching, that you're worshiping me in vain by your tradition. And then in order to show that it's not the external, it's the hands that's the issue is the heart. He says in verse 11, not that which goes into the mouth defiles a man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. That is called a parable. In Matthew chapter 15 and verse 15, Peter called it a parable. And then Yeshua went on to say that the things that proceed out of the heart of man, verse 18, they defile the man. So Yeshua is asking a question about following the oral law and whether that should be done. And why his disciples in this area was not following the oral law. That is the context of Matthew in chapter 15. The context isn't Yeshua was trying to teach that you could eat anything that you want, because the Torah has already determined in Leviticus chapter 11 those foods that are considered clean foods and those that are considered unclean. And if something is unclean, it's forbidden to be eaten. And if it's forbidden to be eaten, it's not really regarded as food. Food is that which is permitted. That which I'm permitted to eat, that's what I'm going to call food. If it's something that I'm not permitted to eat, I'm not going to call it food if I'm not supposed to eat it. And so we've given a new definition to food as anything that we think that we could eat. And most people, if a snake is killed on the road, they wouldn't go out and skin that snake and take it home and eat it, that which was killed on the road, and call that food. That's not regarded as food to them. And so we have our own man-made definitions of what we think food is and what's permitted to eat and not eat. But at the same time, we have certain things that we don't consider food, even though you could eat it and you could put it in your mouth. And so we want to explain to you Matthew chapter 15 in a Hebraic context. And the issue is how you follow the Torah and not whether you can eat whatever food that you want. We'll be back in a moment. Shalom. I'm Eddie Chumney of Hebraic Heritage Ministries. And it is your love offerings and donations that make this television network possible. And we would encourage you to partner with us in sharing this message of Yeshua and the Torah to the nations. We are growing, and in order to continue to grow, we need your support for hiring new staff, for new equipment, and to produce these quality television programs. And so we're calling for a Gideon army of 300 people to donate $50 a month to help us in this effort. Be a part of Gideon's army today. Welcome back, and let's continue in our studies. We're doing a series on Torah in the New Testament, and we're looking at certain verses in the New Testament that traditional Christianity has quoted as justification of why, if you believe in Yeshua as the Messiah, that you're not supposed to follow the Torah. So we're taking different verses and we are examining them in detail. In this series, we've already looked at John chapter 1, verse 17, Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. And in this session, we are looking at Matthew in chapter 15. And so really what Yeshua is doing in his teachings and his ministry, and in truth, what Paul is doing is teaching us how to correctly follow the Torah, not whether we should follow the Torah or not. Because in 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, it says, whoever commits sin transgresses the Torah, for sin is the transgression of the Torah. And Paul said in Romans in chapter 6, verse 1, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. What is he asking? Shall we continue in sin? Shall we continue sinning? What is sinning? Transgressing the Torah. Shall we continue transgressing the Torah so that God's grace may abound toward us? Well, he says, God forbid, that we shouldn't live a lifestyle seeking to sin, seeking to transgress the Torah. So, let's now do a more detailed analysis and study and background of Matthew chapter 15, since we've given you now the overview of what this chapter is about. Let's go to the Torah and see that the Torah teaches that there are clean beasts and unclean beasts. There's clean food and unclean. And this was even understood in the days of Noah. So in Genesis in chapter 7 and verses 1 and 2, it is written, "The Lord said to Noah, 'Come you and all your house into the ark, for you have I seen righteous before me in this generation. And of every clean beast you shall take to you by sevens, the male and his female, and of the beasts that are not clean by two, male and female.'" Therefore, we see that in the days of Noah, there were animals that were considered clean and those unclean. Now we look at Leviticus in chapter 11 and verses 46 and 47. It is written, "This is the law of the beasts, of the fowl, and of every living creature that moves in the waters, and of every creature that creeps upon the earth, to make a difference between the unclean and the clean, between the beast that may be eaten and the beast that may not be eaten." And then, one of the commandments of a priest of God in Leviticus chapter 10:10 is this, that you may put a difference between the holy and the unholy, between the clean and the unclean. We can also see this by going to the book of Ezekiel. So we want to go to Ezekiel and chapter 44 and verse 23. Ezekiel chapter 44 and verse 23, it says, "And they shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the profane, and cause them to discern between the unclean and the clean." So a priest of the God of Israel, one of the commandments toward him in Malachi in chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 6, it says, "And now, O ye priests, this commandment is for you." Verse 6, "The Torah of truth was in his mouth." So the Torah of the God of Israel is supposed to be in the mouth or the teaching of a priest, and he's supposed to teach the people the difference between the clean and the unclean. And so this involves food as well. Now, Deuteronomy in chapter 14 and verse 6, it is written, "And every beast that parts the hoof and cleaves the cleft into two claws and chews the cud among all beasts, you shall eat." And so a cow is a clean animal. Now, in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 9, it says, "These you shall eat of all those that are in the waters, all that has fins and scales." So, a fish that has fins and scales is clean. And then in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 11, "And of all clean birds you shall eat." And so, a chicken is a clean bird. But in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 3, it says, "You shall not eat any abominable thing." And part of the instruction of what's unclean and you are not supposed to eat is Leviticus chapter 11 and verse 7. It says, "And the swine or the pig, though he divides the hoof and be cloven-footed, yet he chews not the cud, he is unclean to you." Goes on in Leviticus chapter 11, verses 41 and 42, "Of every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth shall be an abomination, it shall not be eaten. Whosoever goes upon the belly, and whatsoever goes upon all four, or whatsoever has more feet among all creeping things that creeps upon the earth, them you shall not eat, they are an abomination." You know, I just heard here the other day, there was an article on the internet that there was an eating contest, and someone ate roaches and worms, which are unclean, and as a result of eating the roaches and the worms, the person died. And so this is not to be what you are to be eaten to be healthy. And so now, Leviticus chapter 11, verses 13 and 14. And these are they which shall have an abomination among the fowls. They shall not be eaten. And among the birds that are not to be eaten is vultures. And so, therefore, we can see from these things that the Torah definitely defines what is clean and unclean. And that which is clean is permitted to be eaten. That which is unclean is not permitted. If it's not permitted, it's not considered food if you're not supposed to eat it. You know, before me here is a table. I don't eat a table. So to me, that's not food. So that which I don't eat should not be regarded biblically as being defined as food. Now, at first glance, if you just look at Matthew chapter 15, verse 11, and only quote that scripture, here's what it seems to say. Not that which goes into the mouth defiles a man, but that which comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. What it seems to say in surface, and it says, not that which goes into the mouth defiles man. And so, on surface, this would seem to say that it's not what you eat that makes you unclean. But the Bible says that no single scripture is of any private interpretation. And the way that we are to look at scripture in 1 Corinthians in chapter 2 and verse 13, it says, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but that which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. So we're to compare scripture with scripture. We're going to look at things in context. And so what Yeshua is doing is he's giving you the correct interpretation of how you are to follow the Torah in Matthew chapter 15. And the issue is the way he was instructing the disciples to follow the Torah was not the same as the Pharisees were teaching the people to follow the Torah. They were doing it by oral law. And Yeshua, being the one that gave the Torah, was given the correct interpretation. Now, there is a Jewish understanding that when the Messiah comes, he will teach what's called the sod of the Torah, the heart of the Torah, the real meaning and intent of the Torah. And so that is what Yeshua is doing in correctly teaching the Torah. He's showing what the heart of the commandment is about. It is about having a clean heart before the God of Israel. And so in Job chapter 14, verse 4, it says, who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean? Not one. And so if your heart is unclean, which is what Yeshua made the point of in Matthew in chapter 15, in verse 19, for out of the heart proceeds evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witnesses, blasphemies. And Yeshua also taught that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. If the heart is unclean, what good is it to do to wash your hands externally and think that you're clean before the God of Israel? This is the point that Yeshua was trying to make, because the Pharisees always washed their hands before they ate. So, Matthew chapter 15, verse 18, Yeshua says that, look at your heart and consider the heart. And so, In the Torah Anthology, volume 17, page 32, and this is rabbinical commentary on the book of Deuteronomy, it says the following: ritual washing of both hands before a meal containing bread is mandatory, even if your hands do not need washing. And so with that in mind, let's look at Luke in chapter 11, in verses 37 and 38, and it is written, "And as he spake, a certain Pharisee besought him to dine with him." So Yeshua is going to have dinner with a Pharisee. Now, the Pharisees, once again, believe that the way that you follow the Torah is through the oral law, and they view that the oral law supersedes that which is written. And it's the rabbis who give the oral law interpretation. And their interpretation, it is taught, is infallible. The teaching is that what they teach is the same as God saying it. And so in verse 38, when the Pharisee saw it, he marveled at Yeshua that he had not first washed before dinner. So Yeshua was violating oral law, at least this particular aspect of oral law. And Yeshua used this opportunity to make the same point that he was making in Matthew chapter 15. The Lord said to him, "Now do you Pharisees make clean the outside of the cup and the platter?" The outside meaning the physical hands, washing the physical hands. "You make it clean, but your inward part is full of ravening and wickedness." And so he's making the point that what the God of Israel desires is for your heart to be right, your heart to be pure before him. And it says in Psalm, in chapter 24, Psalm chapter 24, verse 3, "Who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord?" That's Mount Zion. "And who will stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation." So those who have a pure heart before him. See, that's why it then says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 22, "Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith." And so Yeshua said the issue is all about the heart. It is all about the condition of the heart and having a clean heart before the God of Israel as you express and seek to keep his commandments and follow his Torah. And so now let's review again the outline of Matthew chapter 15, verse 1. "Then came to Yeshua scribes and Pharisees from Jerusalem, saying, Why do the disciples transgress the tradition of the elders?" So why aren't they following and practicing, observing the Torah as it was taught by the Pharisees, by the rabbis? That is because Yeshua is discipling his people. And he's teaching them to follow the Torah as he gave it. He is the one that gave the Torah. And so he's comparing and contrasting not whether if you should follow the Torah, but how you should follow the Torah. And Yeshua is explaining the heart of the commandments, which is to have a clean heart before the God of Israel. And the God of Israel is not so much concerned with the external flesh. He's concerned with the thought and the intent of the heart. In Hebrews, in chapter 4 and verse 12, it says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and joint and marrow, and it is a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart." And so that's why the scripture says that man looks outwardly, but the God of Israel looks into the heart and what is on the inside of a person. So when Yeshua died and brought in the new covenant or the renewed covenant, it is his Torah written upon our heart. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 33. "But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my Torah in their inward part, and I will write it in their hearts. And when I write my Torah in their inward part, I will be their God, and they will be my people." This is quoted in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 10. And so then in Psalm, in chapter 40 and verse 8, it is written, "I delight to do your will, O my Elohim. Your Torah is within my heart." So the new covenant is the Torah written upon our heart. And to do the will of God is that his Torah is indeed written upon our heart. And how is the Torah to be written upon our heart? It's to be written upon our heart by the Holy Spirit. So even David prayed in Psalm chapter 51 in verse 10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." And then he says, "Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me." Verse 13, "Then will I teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted unto me." And so in Psalm chapter 51, verse 17, it says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." And so then he explains that when our heart is right, then we can bring our offering before the Lord. Verse 19, "Then shall you be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then shall they offer bullocks upon my altar." And so if you just externally bring things before the altar of God, bring the burnt offering and the various sacrifices before him, and your heart is not still right before him, God does not accept the external when the internal still has a problem. And this is the issue that he makes to his people in Isaiah chapter 1, where it says, Isaiah 1:4, "O sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors, they have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger." And then it goes on to say, verse 11, "To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me, says the Lord? I am full of the burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of goats. And when you come to appear before me, who has required this at your hand? Bring no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and the Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is an iniquity, even your solemn meeting, your new moon and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They are a trouble to me. I am weary of them. And so, ultimately, the complaint is the heart and the attitude of his people. Verse 15, and when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Why? Your hands are full of blood. So it says in verse 16, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well, seek righteousness, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. And that's exactly the point that Yeshua made in his teachings to the Pharisees. He made the point that don't focus on the external if your heart is not right. And even in the Psalms, David prayed, renew a right spirit within me. Then I will teach sinners the correct way to come before the Lord. And then he says, then will your offerings be accepted upon my altar. And so Yeshua then taught that before you come to the God of Israel, if you have aught with your brother, go to your brother, make things right, and then come before me. So Yeshua was teaching what was taught in the Torah. He was teaching what David said. He was teaching what the prophets, what Isaiah said. He was making the exact same points to the Pharisees of the Torah, the prophets, and the Psalms. And so this is the context of Matthew in chapter 15. And this is how we need to understand the things that are going on here. We cannot take a verse in isolation, like we have done, Matthew chapter 15, verse 11, and look at it independent of context, and then use the words, not that which goes into the mouth defiles a man, and then make a doctrine of it that we can eat anything that we want. This is an example of destroying the Torah, incorrectly teaching it. As Yeshua said, he did not come to incorrectly teach the Torah or to destroy it, Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, but he came to give the correct interpretation. And this is what he's doing in Matthew chapter 15. And the correct interpretation of understanding Yeshua is he's our Savior. We need to repent of our sins, and we need to love him by keeping his commandments or following his Torah. Shalom in Yeshua the Messiah. Amen.